but other people see us and they think we're actually different. And so I had this idea one day. I'm like, dog, I'm black as fuck as anybody else. I'm like, there's nothing that's less black about me. I have just become very adept at making you comfortable, and I'm kind
of
tired of it.
So I'm glad that you go into that, man, because I like the concept of, you know, right now it feels like there's a lot of concepts that are out there where you're saying one thing and people are turning it into a completely different thing. I mean, it's nothing new. It's just hitting a plateau, I think, right now, where basically you can use words, describe what they mean, put them out there, and people still are going to listen to that, look you right in the face, and decide it means something else. So, yep. You know, with Black as Fuck, I love how two things. Number one, I can see it in the shirt right here. You stylize it in a way where it's very clear what you're saying, but at the same time, it still is something that you can take anywhere and make people have to accept it, and they can't reject it based on the way that it's displayed.
You don't like these letters? You don't like all these letters scrambled up on my chest? What are you going to do?
You can't watch Wheel of Fortune and then reject that shirt. It just doesn't work that way. But the thing I really like about it, though, is how it's basically like fill in the blank is Black as Fuck. You know what I'm saying? So, like, talk to me a little bit about, you know, how you got to that concept and just how many different ways you really think that message can get driven.
So I'm a parent, right? And I think one of the most significant charges of being a parent is that you have to constantly be better in yourself so that you can pour into somebody else younger, right? And so as culturally aware as I am, as conscious as I am about what we've done, the more I start biting off this apple of Blackness, I realize I'm insufficient. I don't have enough of my own understanding about our culture for me to and then impart that greatness into my children, right? So I'm out here thinking about, every day I'm looking at, like, what's black today? And I'll find something black. I'm like, I never knew that was black. You know, I never knew that was black at all. And so I'm like, man, you know, the Kentucky Derby is black as fuck.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, people don't know that. People don't know that.
Black.
The first jockeys were black. The first jockeys were black.
The first winner of the Kentucky Derby was black as fuck. And more importantly, 12 out of the 15 of those racers were black. 12 out of 15. So not only were we involved in the sport, but we were the sport of the Kentucky Derby, right? But who knows that? Now, we know about the singular instances of it, right? We know about, all them big hats got to come from black churches. Where else would you get them from, right? So we know about all those aspects of it, but we didn't understand how critical we were to that thing becoming what it is today. And truth be told, that's a lot of our experience in this world because we were doing so much work behind the scenes, right? So who was raising the horses? It was black hands in the fields raising the horses. Who had the best relationship with the horses? Who understood the horses the best in that? It was the people who were dealing with them hours and hours and hours upon hours every day. We should have been recognized as the best in that, but we, like any other history that happens in America, gets kind of to the winners go to spoils, right? And so that's the kind of how history is written. And I'm like, we have to start changing that narrative. And as I start exploring this for my own children, I'm like, well, other people need to hear about this too, because I'm pretty sure that nobody knows about, like, if you say Jerry Lawson, unless you're just a video game, like, the God, you say Jerry Lawson, and I wouldn't even say video game God. I would almost argue that most of the folks over in FaZe Clan electronic gaming, right, they have no clue who Jerry Lawson is. But right. Jerry Lawson was the black man who developed the cartridge for a gaming system. So, you know, and think about the profitability that happened as a result of you being able to exchange cartridges versus having to buy a new gift system with games being loaded. But how many times have we taught about Jerry Lawson? How many times have we been taught about Steve Jobs?
Yeah.
Right? So, and what I've realized is, I tell people all this time, the older you get, the blacker you get, because this country will make, right? It will make you get more committed to who you are, because you will, at some point you become, after all those years and years and years of saying, who I am wasn't good enough, you start rejecting it. He said, you know what, I'm just as good as anybody else out here. So you get blacker and blacker the older you get. And what I wanted to do was, as I start going down this whole path of exploration, and Black as Fuck is a very much in evolution at all times, right? It goes from being a t-shirt thing to a podcast thing to a blog thing, but it's really just the aggregation of all this experience that I'm trying to learn as much as I can about myself and our people so that I can give a better head start to my children and how confident they are about their Blackness. Because a lot of us became confident in our Blackness after the fact, right? After we had already been socialized to believe a certain thing about Black communities. And then we had to go out there and actually find out the truth.
And I think that's a good point. That's a question actually I'd ask both of y'all, because I think that one thing that is definitely that education piece, you know, that's a huge part of it. And that's something that I can recall, you know, talking about around the time back a few months ago when Juneteenth really took on its prevalence at a much higher profile level than ever before. And, you know, it was a piece of things where I saw a lot of people having to reckon with the fact that it just wasn't something that they were educated on, Black and white alike, you know, but with it being the level of importance for it and it being something that was kind of glossed over, to your point about to the victors go to spoils. But I know that both of you being parents and having kids that are at different points in their education, but are, you know, you're having to take on that responsibility of guiding that and putting things in play. How important and how much room do you have to be able to institute some of the things that you care about and you know should be in the curriculum that maybe you're not seeing, but now you're having an opportunity to put those things in front of them in a different way?
I would say my experience, my desire to be more conscious of my Blackness is, and more proud of my Blackness is that is also a direct reflection of the fact that I made a choice to put my son and my daughter in a school environment where they are one of, right? Mm. So in doing that and making that choice, I also said to myself, if we're going to let this happen, the responsibility of them being well-formed and as to who they are as Black people now totally falls on my shoulders. Because I can't send you to this lily white environment and then ask you to come out, like Sojourner Truth. It's just not going to happen, right? We are all functions of our environment. So it became my responsibility. It also became my my desire to put a shield around my children, right? Because undoubtedly, I just heard a story today from a friend who said her white friend called her and said, "You won't believe this. We had a guy over at the house, and I'm about to leave my husband," is what she really said. "I'm leaving him," because the 2-year-old daughter went up to the Mexican guy who was cutting the lawn and called him a nigger.
Oh.
Right? 2-year-old daughter, Mexican guy, nigger. That's all learned behavior, mm-hmm. right? And so I'm like, when I said, you know, I was going to all of the private school meetings and my hands folded because I ain't hearing none of this stuff. I'm over here like, yeah, man, I came out of public school in St. Louis. He'll be all right. He just going to take some shots. You know, it is what it is, which is a ridiculous idea in itself, right? Especially if we talk about moving the needle forward. Why would my son have to run from cops like I had to when I was young? Like, mm-hmm. one, you ain't even going to be in them neighborhoods, bro. That's just the reality of it. Like, you probably ain't going to live in that experience. I can't be teaching my children for that experience. However, I also have to teach them to be protective of their Blackness, right? So this whole schooling experience, and we're going around, and then it's a double-edged sword, because at the same time that I have a responsibility for making sure that they are confident in being Black, I also have a responsibility for setting them up educationally so that they can be successful in this very white world. That's just the reality of it. I have to do both of those things at the same time, and I think that is unique to our culture. I don't think that's something, maybe the Latin folks deal with it, Hispanic folks deal with it a little bit. But I think that is unique to our culture, where we, at the same time that we want to protect them and put them in all Black environments, because this we know is going to be the way that they become confident in themselves. We also know that we got to put them in school environments where they get the best education, because the environments that where the blacks are going to school are underfunded, been left to die for decades, mm-hmm. right? So it's a very tough spot to be a parent in that environment. But I just have got, like I said, the older I get, the blacker I get, the less I care. And truth be told, my goal is to educate all those white people as well about how great blackness has been to their community, right? And from the beginning of time, blackness has been an additive, a positive additive to their community. And the only reason is they weren't informed of as well. They drink the same Kool-Aid that we were drinking. So if the people that I have earned relationship with, the people that I've earned an audience with, y'all just gonna have to be comfortable with me being black as fuck from this point forward, because I ain't got no other choice. It is required for me to exist, is to be able to live in my skin as my skin is, with no kind of hindrances or you know, just not being having to hold it back in any way.
Daryl, what's been your thoughts on that? As the resident blackest person I know, man, I know that this is probably me lighting a powder keg for you, what's been your thoughts in seeing that, and especially having to reconcile, you know, seeing a daughter that's really getting, you know, getting up.
Xander's yeah, she just turned seven. Birthday. Yeah, she just turned seven on Wednesday.
So,
yeah.
I mean, you know, she's past kindergarten age. You know, I mean, she's starting to get to that point where those curriculums and those, you know, things.
Oh,
that, you know,
we had a thing, though. She did a
social
thing.
Social studies is a real
thing. So we're
doing
it at home, though. So she's with me at home during the week for school. So, man, she did
so
a
thing. So you got her listening to, like, Whitey's on the Moon. And,
no, I make her listen to the song. Her middle name is Asada. I named her after Asada Shakur. So. So I make her listen to the song, my common song for Asada, like all the time. They're like, this is where your name came from. And she, you know, she'll tell you where her name came from. Like Asada Shakur, she's a political prisoner in Cuba, you know, but I don't think she understands it necessarily. She just knows where it comes from. But I wanted to beat her, you know, because I was up there. If she ever wanted to like become like non-political, or like she would try to become a Republican or like a Sambo, like they could always look up to her middle name as Asada. And then like, it would always like be a spurn on her side of not being black. You know, so yeah. Like just stop her from going to the dark side at all times.
Hey, that middle name, that's no joke, man, because that middle name will pop up on you. That's like when I saw Stephen Colbert middle name was Tyrone.